Hello. Today I will introduce the concept of traveling waves on transmission lines and in cable. Voltage and current surges propagate through lines as waves traveling back and forth between line or cable ends. The waves are reflected at both line ends, and the amplitude of this reflection is a function of the line termination on the source as well as on the load side. The surge could be caused by a switch connecting the source to the line. At the instant of closing the switch, the wave surge begins its journey along the line at the propagation speed given by the line parameters as follows. There are two most relevant line parameters to be considered. The first one is the surge impedance and the second one is the propagation speed. The wave propagation speed on overhead lines is typically very close to the speed of light. In cable, however, the propagation speed is around 30% of the speed of light due to the dielectric constant of the cable insulation. Here are the mathematics formula for both the surge impedance and the traveling speed. Here is a traveling wave on an open-end 600 km long overhead line. The dark green, slightly bold curve traveling on the line in forward direction, as well as the blue voltage surge traveling on the line, have been initiated by closing the breaker on the left end of the line. The closing operation of the breaker connects a DC source to the line. The relation between the voltage surge and the current surge is given by the surge impedance of the line. Since the end of the line is open, no current can flow beyond this point. Therefore, 100% of the current is reflected at the end of the line and flows back through the line as shown by the light green trace propagating through the line in backward direction. There is again a reflection at the source side, where the pure voltage source is electrically equal to a short circuit for the backward current traveling wave. The result is a wave traveling back and forth between both line ends. At the load side of the line, the right side, the voltage shape is the shape of a square wave. The amplitude of the voltage at any point of the line is given by the sum of the forward current wave, which is the one traveling from the left to the right in bold dark green, and the backward current wave, which is the light green curve traveling from the right to the left. The frequency of the square wave at the right load side of the line is a function of the line length, in this case 600 km, and the speed of light, as shown in the formula on the earlier slide. So far, the surge on the line traveled without damping. In reality, however, there is a damping for the surge on the line. For this round here, I assume the damping of around 1 microsecond per kilometer. The damping is set up at the reflection point at the beginning and at the end of the line for easy modeling purpose. On a real line, the damping would happen along the line, but there is no relevant change for the voltage and current curves on both line ends. The result can be seen at the voltage curve on the line end to the right side, where the square wave is gradually transformed into a sinusoidal oscillation given the damping of the high frequency spectra. Such a voltage shape is more realistic for such a long line compared to the theoretical square wave shown before. Here is a demo with a line with a short circuit at the end. In this case, the voltage at the line end stays zero, whereas the current grows infinitely on both sides, as expected for an ideal short circuit. To avoid confusion, this time the simulation speed has been accelerated compared to earlier video sequences. For the next sequence of the video, please watch the line terminating resistance at the right end of the transmission line. It has got the same value as the surge impedance of the line. In this specific case, there is no reflection at the line end. The termination resistance is also referred to as the natural load. It is equal to the surge impedance loading of the line. Here I continue to work with the DC source, but I increase the load resistance from previously 240 ohms. Which was equal to the surge impedance loading of the line, to now 1 kilo ohm. And watch the result at the right end of the line. Now I get reflections running back and forth on the line, but now the oscillations are damped compared to the case with an open line end. With www.ecsb.ch, you get to my webpage where for a small fee you can register and access a great browser-based software with lots of features such as line models. You can register by pushing the registration button on the right side of the page. Here is a simple example. Once the circuit is set up, you can enter the transmission line parameters and run the simulation. Then you can see the response at the right end of the 600 kilometer line, and you can vary the value of the termination resistance by means of a slider. This is just a very simple example. It is a great tool to learn or to teach. A limited version is available for free. So far, we used the DC source to demonstrate the principle of wave propagation. Transmission lines are mostly operated within AC systems. Here is a demo of an open end line connected to an AC source. The voltage at the open end of the line is significantly higher than at the beginning of the line. This is called the Ferranti effect. The Ferranti effect increases with line length. Operating such a long line results in a high overvoltage, and this is dangerous for equipment connected to the line end. Therefore, the Ferranti effect must be compensated. A reactor at line end properly adjusted to the reactive power consumption of the line can fully eliminate the overvoltage at the end of the line. An open line exhibits a capacitive characteristics. Therefore, a reactor is needed for overvoltage reduction. In this example, I put the reactor at the end of the line only. In reality, however, the reactor would be distributed to both ends of the line, and in case of very long lines, an additional compensation might be needed in the middle of the line. The full effect of the reactor is visible once the harmonics distortion of the voltage have been damped out. If you watch closely, you see that despite of the compensation at the line end, there is still some overvoltage in the middle of the line. Next, I replace the reactor by a 1 kilo ohm resistor, which is significantly higher than the surge impedance of the line. As a result, I still get some overvoltage, but much less than operating the open end line as shown before. Therefore, in this case, a reactor would be needed at the end of the line as well, but for a lower reactive power rating. This means the reactor would get a higher inductance value. The needed reactive power compensation of a line has to be optimized by the operator. In some cases, even complex variable reactors have to be provided. The simulations performed so far use a line model based on an array of memory for the forward traveling wave and an additional array of memory for the backward traveling wave. The memory works as a delay line, and at each time step, the content of each individual memory segment of the line is copied one step from left to right for the forward wave in the forward array, and one from right to the left for the backward wave in the backward array. So the propagation along the line can be visualized as shown for both for a DC surge as well as for an AC source. This is exactly the model used in www.ecsp.ch. Next come a couple of examples of the power of such a line modeling approach in the circuit simulator www.ecsp.ch. To access one of the line models, you have to be registered. You can do so for a small fee of around $20 per year. As a registered user, you can access single and three-phase line models. The implemented models on ecsp.ch does not show the voltage along the line, but the resulting voltages and currents at both line ends. However, the models shown in this video are exactly the ones implemented. Here is the guide to build up a very simple circuit to start with. First, to clear the canvas, go to the menu bar on the top left and press New. Drag and drop a sinusoidal voltage source from the element selection bar to the canvas. Drag and drop a single line model element from the element selection bar to the canvas and let it snap close to the source. Do the same with the resistor. For a nice looking layout, make sure that all the elements are vertically aligned as shown in the video. Now, connect the elements to each other by connecting lines. First, click on an element connector so that the line is initiated, and move the end of the connector line to the connector of the line to be connected. The bottom connector should all be grounded by an earth sign. Alternatively, you can connect all the bottom connectors by a single line starting from the bottom source connector and ending at the load resistor bottom connector. The next step is to input the element parameters in the element input forms. Double click on the source and enter the voltage, in this case 100 kV. After the input, press Enter for the system to read the input value. For the frequency, the default value is 50 Hz. You can change it to 60 or whatever else you need. If all is OK, press the OK button for this element. Double click now on the line element to open the line input form. enter the damping in microseconds per kilometer. This means that the slope of a surge is decreased by so many microseconds per kilometer. With input zero, there is no damping for the slope at all. Enter the length resistance of the line in ohm per meter. Realistic is something around 10 micro ohm per meter. Enter the surge impedance, the length of the line in meter, and the traveling speed of a surge in percent of the speed of light. 100 is normally good enough for an overhead line. Alternatively to the surge impedance, one can enter the capacitance and the inductance per meter of line. Once done, press OK. Double click on the load resistance to enter the resistance and tick the checkboxes of the traces you want to see. The final step is to run the simulation as follows. Press the green single arrow button or the new steps button. Input the desired meaningful simulation time, in this case 100 milliseconds. Press the adjust button in order to get an output synchronized to the lowest source frequency, in this case 50 Hz. After pressing the adjust button, the number of necessary calculation steps is evaluated automatically, otherwise manual input of the number of steps is required. Continuous simulation is not needed, untick the continuous tick box. Press the OK button and the result is shown on the screen. The position and size of the screen can be adjusted to shift the entire screen. Put the mouse cursor on the screen and drag and drop. To change the size of the screen, drag and drop one corner of the screen. Here comes the same circuit layout, but this time in three-phase arrangement. The required inputs are the same as before. In the line input form for the three-phase lines, however, there is an additional input required for phase coupling. It represents the capacity phase coupling between phases in percent of 1 per unit voltage. If left 0, there is no phase coupling at all. There are two simulation examples, one with 0.2 microsecond per kilometer damping and one with 0.02 microsecond per kilometer. Finally, there is a line with hidden grounding connectors developed for easy power flow simulations. If this type of line is used, an earth must be connected to at least one of the sources for proper functioning. All other features are the same as for the single line element. In case the power flow button is ticked, the power transmitted will be shown by the indicators above elements, including the power flow direction on the lines. These indications, however, represent the three-phase power flow and not the single-phase power flow.